Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. This is the podcast about everything, and wouldn't you know it, we are at the beginning of another letter. How did this happen? I think I have to turn my microphone down a little bit. This is the letter C. Wasn't that last episode of the letter B so amazing? There was a parade, and there was a 21-gun salute, and it was just this amazing party for the end of the letter B. I hope that everybody had a good time partying. All right, so as usual, the first few entries in a letter are, you know, it's the single letter. It's not terribly interesting, but let's see what this one has to say. So the first one is just the letter C. It is lowercase. It is the first form. It is a noun. It doesn't give a year, which I think is interesting. But it's old. Okay, so number one, A, the third letter of the English alphabet. 1B, a graphic representation of this letter. 1C, a speech counterpart of orthographic, and then it shows the letter C. By the way, I should mention that I already put in my notes, my post-it notes on every single page, so I know which date every single one of these lands on. And so what's interesting about the letter C is that it is very long. There are lots of words that start with the letter C. So it's a little bit shorter than A and B combined. It's probably more than a little bit shorter. It's going to be almost exactly a full year and a half of this letter. We are starting on December 11th, and as long as everything goes to plan, we are ending... we are starting on December 11th, 2020, and the letter C won't end until June 30th, 2022. So the entire year of 2021 is going to be the letter C, plus a lot after and a little bit before. Okay, sorry, back to the definitions. We said that one. Now we are on 2A, 100, and then it says to see the number table. 2B is slang. It is a sum of $100. Number three, the keynote of a C major scale. I couldn't say the word scale. Number four, a graphic device for reproducing the letter C. Number five, one designated C, especially as the third in order or class. 6A, a grade rating a student's work as fair or mediocre in quality. Yeah, it's just in the middle, it's average. 6B, one graded or rated with a C, and that's a capital C in this case. 7, something shaped like the letter C. 8, a structured programming language designed to be compact and efficient. Why did they call it C? I've seen C++. Is there a C+? Is there a regular C? Is there a C-? And then why is it called C? Is it because it's compact? Who named this? Okay, that was the first form of C. Now let's say the second form of C. By the way, we're at the bottom of page 170. So this second form of C is an abbreviation for 24 things, at least 24 things. 1, calm. 2, calorie. 3, canceled. 4, candle. 5, carrot, spelled C-A-R-A-T, like carrots in a diamond. 6, catcher. 7, cent, like dollars and cents. 8, centavo. 9, the prefix centi, to say it's like 100, centi, C-E-N-T-I. 10, centime, or centime, C-E-N-T-I-M-E. 11, centimeter. 12, century. 13, chapter. 14, circa, C-I-R-C-A. 15, circumference. 16, cocaine. 17, coefficient. 18, college. 19, okay, so this is interesting. It's for the word gallon, but the reason it's a C abbreviation is because the Latin word is congius or congius, C-O-N-G-I-U-S. So that's where the C is. Which is an abbreviation for gallon. 20, contra alto. 21, copyright. 22, cubic. 23, cup. and 24 Curie, or Curie, like Marie Curie. Marie, is that her name? Yeah, C-U-R-I-E. Okay, next is the first form of the capital version of just the letter C. This is an abbreviation for one, capacitance. Capacitance. That's like how much capacity I think it has. Two, Celsius. Three, centigrade. Which are Celsius and centigrade the same thing? Or are they different? I thought maybe they were sort of similar. Anyway, four, coulomb. C-O-U-L-O-M-B. Five, cytosine. C-Y-T-O-S-I-N-E. Cytosine. Next is the second form of the capital C. This is a symbol for carbon. One of the most important atoms in our world and probably the universe. We are carbon-based life forms. We'll learn more about that later. Next is CA, all lowercase, abbreviation for circa. I see that a lot when we're talking about a date when a thing happened, like circa the 14th century, circa 1865. Next is capital C, lowercase a. This is a symbol for calcium, also very important to us humans. Next is capital C, capital A, abbreviation for 1, California, 2, Central America, 3, certified acupuncturist, 4, chartered accountant, 5, chief accountant, 6, chronological age, 7, commercial agent, 8, controller of accounts, 9, current account. What is your chronological age? I think that is literally just how old your body is, how many years you've been on this planet. But then there are other ages, and I don't know what they're called. I don't know what the adjective is before that, but it's probably like, how old do you feel? And how old physically are you, you know, based on the degradation of your body? I actually find these really interesting. I started asking people this question. How old do you feel mentally? How old do you feel physically? And how old are you actually? Okay, next is CA with an apostrophe at the end. And then this is a Scottish variation of the word call, C-A-L-L. Next is the first form of cab, C-A-B, noun from 1535, an ancient Hebrew unit of capacity equal to about 2 quarts, which is about 2.2 liters. Interesting. So then this is from the Hebrew word. I assume it is pronounced something close to cab or cob. Yeah, it's probably cob. And then the Hebrew word is spelled Q-A-B-H. So it's an amount of liquid, give or take 2 quarts. Now we have the second form of cab, noun from 1826, 1A1, synonym is cabriolet, C-A-B-R-I-O-L-E-T, and that is actually what this word is short for. It's short for just cabriolet, so I guess they're all sort of connected to that in some way. 1A2, a similar light closed carriage, as a hansom, H-A-N-S-O-M, I guess that is a carriage. I'm not exactly sure what a cabriolet is. I think I've heard it in terms of cars. There might be a car called a cabriolet, but there must be a sort of an older definition of what a cabriolet is. It's probably just a carriage, really. All right, 1B, a carriage for hire. 2, synonym is taxicab. 3 is, so we got 3A and 3B, and they are both short for cabin. So I thought all of these would be short for cabriolet because that's where the etymology is normally. If it had been just for one, the number one definitions, they should put it after the one, but they didn't. So, okay. Anyway, number 3 is short for cabin. 3A, the part of a locomotive that houses the engineer and operating controls. 3B, a comparable shelter as on a truck. Housing, operating, controls. A comparable shelter, housing, operating, controls. It is the cab. That's where the stuff happens. Third form of cab, intransitive verb from 1835, to travel in a cab, as in cabbed back to the hotel. Fourth form of cab, noun from 1986, And the synonym is Cabernet Sauvignon. It's a kind of wine. Because nobody has time to say that. Nobody can say Cabernet Sauvignon. Some people can't pronounce it, so they just say Cab. Next is Cab, all caps, abbreviation for Civil Aeronautics Board. Next is Cabal, C-A-B-A-L, first form, noun from 1614. One, the artifices and intrigues of a group of persons secretly united in a plot as to overturn a government. Also, a group engaged in such artifices and intrigues. Number two, synonyms are club and group, as in a cabal of artists. And then a synonym at the end is the word plot, P-L-O-T. Let's see, this is from the French word cabale, which means cabala or intrigue or cabal, from Middle Latin cabala, which is from the Lower Hebrew cabala, spelled with a Q, and that literally means received. And then in parentheses it says lore, L-O-R-E. So are you receiving the lore? Yeah, it's a lot about just secret stuff and plotting and, yeah, all right. Now we have the second form of cabal. This is a verb, intransitive verb from 1678, to unite in or form a cabal. Next is cabala, C-A-B-A-L-A, or you could have two B's, or you could have two B's plus an H at the very end. This is a variation of cabala, spelled K-A-B-B-A-L-A-H. Next is cabaletta. You should be able to figure out how to spell that one if you want. It has two T's. It is a noun from 1842. One, an operatic song in simple popular style characterized by a uniform rhythm. Number two, the lively bravura, concluding section of an extended aria or duet. The lively bravura, concluding section of an extended aria or duet. Yeah, it's an Italian word, cabaletta. Next we have cabalist, first form noun from circa 1533. One is often capitalized, a student, interpreter, or devotee of the Jewish Kabbalah. Two, one skilled in esoteric doctrine or mysterious art. Next, we have the second form of cabalist, noun from 1569, a member of a cabal. And then lastly for this episode, we have, you could pronounce it a couple ways, caballero or caballero, C-A-B-A-L-L-E-R-O. I personally prefer the second pronunciation, caballero, because it is a Spanish word, and then when there's the two L's next to each other, they have a ya sound, like a Y, instead of an L. So, let's see, this is a noun from 1749. Number one, synonyms are knight, with a K, and cavalier. And then number two is chiefly southwestern, the synonym is horseman. And yeah, this is a Spanish word from the Latin word caballarius or caballarius, which means holster. And there's more at the word cavalier. Yeah, so those were all the words we had. C, 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 A, C, A, C, A, ca, cab, cab, cabal, cabala, cabaletta, cabalist, and caballero. Let's see. Well, I think I'm going to pick cabaletta, C-A-B-A-L-E-T-T-A, as the word of the episode because it's music and it's, you know, I didn't want to pick this things that are about secrecy and plotting. I don't know, that seems sort of deceiving. So I liked cabaletta. Maybe I should go listen to some music that is a cabaletta. All right, well, thank you very much for joining me on this journey. This is so much the beginning, especially the beginning of this season. We have a long way to go before we get to the end. But hey, that's what this is all about. Let's have some fun with it. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. We are chugging right along with the letter C. Top of page 171. First word is cabana. C-A-B-A-N-A. Noun from 1891, a lightweight structure with living facilities. Two, a tent-like shelter, usually with an open side facing a beach or swimming pool. That sounds really great right now since we are in December here in the Northern Hemisphere. Next is cabaret. Noun from, where's the date? 1655. Number one is archaic. A shop selling wines and liquors. 2A, a restaurant serving liquor and providing entertainment, as by singers or dancers. Synonym is nightclub. 2B, the show provided at a cabaret. I never saw that show, Cabaret. I think I should watch it. It's supposed to be a good show. Probably will watch the movie and not actually see it on stage. So let's see. This is, I'm looking at the etymology. Some of it doesn't totally make sense, but it's got the words Picard and Walloon in here. I have no idea what those mean. I don't know if those are languages or locations or people. But it looks like this is essentially from, or one of the parts is camberete, which is a small room, and ultimately from the Latin word camera, or it's spelled camera, and then there's more at the word chamber. So it's just a room that happens to have shows and singers and dancers and alcohol, and probably food. Next is cabbage, first form, noun from the 15th century, 1A. Any of several brassicas, of European origin, especially a leafy garden plant with a short stem and a dense globular head of usually green leaves that is used as a vegetable. The scientific name, which I had to look this up and I'll probably forget again, I think it's binomial nomenclature. I wonder if I even mentioned that in an old episode. Anyway, binomial nomenclature is the official name when you have those two or three, usually two, but sometimes three, sort of Latin words. And so this one is Brassica oleracea. And then there was another one, Brassica oleracea capitata. Capitata. I don't know if it having a third one means it's something else. But yeah, sometimes there's two, sometimes there's three. Moving on to 1B, any of several plants related to or resembling cabbage. You gotta eat your cabbage. It's very healthy for you. Eat some on occasion, just like with all your other vegetables. Number two is slang. Synonyms are money and cash. Cabbagey, spelled a couple ways, is an adjective. It's so cabbagey. So here we're seeing this, these Norman and Picard, these must be locations in France because they're coming after, it says Middle French dialect, Norman and Picard. In the last one, it was also Middle French dialect, Picard and Walloon. So I should probably look that up. But anyway, cabbage literally means head or noggin. It just looks like your head. Second form of cabbage, noun from no year. Pieces of cloth left in cutting out garments and traditionally kept by tailors as perquisites? What is this word? Perquisite, I don't know. Perquisites. Perquisites. But no, that's not how you'd say it. Perquisites? Oh boy, I sound so dumb right now. Anyway, this is perhaps by folk etymology from the Middle French cabas, which means cheating or theft. I feel like there's a story in there somewhere. Like the little elves would take away the cuttings left that were cut out of garments, and they would maybe make their own garments. I don't know. We should look this up and see. And then why was it called cabbage? Did they look like little pieces of cabbage? All right, next is the third and final form of cabbage, transitive verb from 1691. And this looks like it's related to the last one. The synonyms are steal and filch. So if you steal something, you're cabbaging it. I mean, it literally shows that the other forms are cabbaged and cabbaging. All right. Next is cabbage butterfly. Two words, noun from 1781. Any of several largely white butterflies whose green larvae are cabbage worms, especially a small cosmopolitan butterfly that is a pest on cabbage and is also called cabbage white. So it doesn't look like cabbage, it eats cabbage. And then the family name is Pereridae, and the, I'm just going to keep on calling it the scientific name because it's too hard to say, binomial nomenclature. Those are Pyrrhus rapi, also Artogia rapi. Artogia rapi. Okay, moving on to cabbage looper, two words, noun from 1895. A noctuid moth, I assume that has to do with nighttime, N-O-C-T-U-I-D, a noctuid moth having pale green white-striped larvae that feed on cruciferous plants. Again, it's a thing that eats on these cabbages and other similar things, but this one is a moth. But why'd they call it a looper? The scientific name is Trichoplusia ni, N-I, or is it just Ni? It's the shortest scientific name I've ever seen in one word, just N-I. Next is cabbage palm, two words, noun from 1770. A palm with terminal buds eaten as a vegetable. Next is cabbage palmetto, noun from 1802. A cabbage palm with fan-shaped leaves native to coastal southeastern U.S. and the Bahamas. And the scientific name is Sabal palmetto. Next is cabbage rose, two words, noun from 1795. A fragrant garden rose with upright branches and large pink flowers. And the scientific name is Rosa centifolia. I don't think I was supposed to roll my R on that. I just felt like doing it. Rosa centifolia. Next is cabbage worm. We saw this back in the cabbage butterfly definition. So cabbage worm is two words, noun from 1688. An insect larva, as of a cabbage butterfly, that feeds on cabbages. Next is cabbie, C-A-B-B-I-E or C-A-B-B-Y, noun from 1840. Synonym is cab driver, which is next. Cab driver, one word. It would be great if Adam Driver was a cab driver. Noun from 1825, a driver of a cab, which we can assume is probably short for cabriolet. Let's see. So next we have caber. I think caber or cobber, C-A-B-E-R, noun from 1505. We have the synonym pole, P-O-L-E, like a flagpole, especially a young tree trunk used for tossing as a trial of strength in a Scottish sport. And this is from the Scottish Gaelic word cabar, C-A-B-A-R. How do they pronounce it? Probably caber or cobber. So yeah, it's just a big, probably big tree trunk that they use to throw and make them feel better about themselves because they are so strong, and then they get a reward or an award. Do they get money? Do they get cheese that they can chase down a rolling hill? That didn't make any sense. That's a caber. I'm sure you can find video of people throwing these around. Next is Cabernet Franc, two words, noun from 1952. Seems later than I would have expected. It is a dry red wine often used in blends, as with Merlot or Cabernet Sauvignon. This is a French word, obviously, and it literally means pure Cabernet. And so does Franc mean pure, or are they just, it must, I guess, does that mean that the word, that the name France is pure? I should look into this. Next, we have Cabernet Sauvignon, noun from 1886, a dry red wine made from a single widely cultivated variety of black grape, called also just Cabernet. Next, we have CABG, all caps, abbreviation for coronary artery bypass graft, something that you probably don't want. And then lastly, we have just the word cabin. It's an easy word. I understand what this one is. First form, noun from the 14th century. 1A1, a private room on a ship or boat. 1A2, a compartment below deck on a boat used for living accommodations. 1B, the passenger or cargo compartment of a vehicle. as an airplane or automobile. 1C, the crew compartment of an exploratory vehicle as a spacecraft. I want to go in a spacecraft. Number 2, a small one-story dwelling, usually of simple construction. Make sure it's not in the woods, because then it will probably be very scary to you. But also, any of you adults, you should go watch Cabin in the Woods if you haven't, because that is a great movie. And then 3 is chiefly British, and we just have the number 3 definition for the word cab, which... where is that? Oh, it's, yeah, it's just short for cabin. It's a cabin. Oh, locomotive, the cabin, or, the cabin in a truck, something like that. All right. So we had cabana, cabaret, cabbage, cabbage butterfly, cabbage looper, cabbage palm, cabbage palmetto, cabbage rose, cabbage worm, cabbie, cab driver, caber, cabernet franc, cabernet sauvignon, C-A-B-G, and cabin. You know, if it were a different person sitting here, they would probably pick something like Cabernet Sauvignon or something like that. If there was a cabbage butterfly reading this dictionary, they would probably pick cabbage as their word because they love to eat cabbage. I think just because it's all about just fun and enjoying your night out, I think I'm just going to pick cabaret as the word of the episode. I don't know. That seems like a good one. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information to you. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. This is my podcast. I have a correction before we get going on this episode. In the last episode, we had CABG all caps, which was an abbreviation for coronary artery bypass graft. And when I finished recording that episode, my wife said, it's not pronounced CABG, it's actually pronounced cabbage. So in the medical community, if you're in that community, you were probably very angry that I said it wrong. No, but it's they say cabbage. And basically what it is if there's a problem with one of your coronary arteries, then the doctors will take an artery from another part of your body and they will graft it onto your heart. Like if the artery has a clog, I cannot think of the word right now, but if there's a problem with it and the blood isn't pumping through, then they can get another artery and attach it into the proper area, and it's bypassing the bad artery and it's using the good artery. So now you'll learn something just like I did. All right, so the first word for this episode is cabin, second form, verb from 1586, to live in or as if in a cabin. Let's go cabin. And then we have transitive. Synonyms are confine and restrain, as in significantly cabins the discretion of administrators. That is a quote from A.M. Dershowitz. Significantly cabins the discretion of administrators. It's very, I don't know, bureaucratic almost. Maybe we should see where that one's from. Next we have Cabin Boy, a very silly movie that I don't really remember, but I should watch it again. Noun from 1670, a boy working as servant on a ship. Next is cabin, car, two words, noun from 1871. Synonym is caboose, like the caboose of a train. Next is cabin, class, two words, noun from 1895. A class of accommodations on a passenger ship, superior to tourist class and inferior to first class. So it's better than tourist class, but not quite as good as first class. It's cabin class. Next, we have cabin cruiser, two words, noun from 1896, and we just have the 1B definition for the word cruiser. Next is cabinet, first form, noun from circa 1550, 1A, a case or cupboard, usually having doors and shelves. 1B, a collection of specimens, especially of biological or numismatic interest. Numismatic. I feel like I've heard of this word, but I do not know what that means. Numismatic. dictionary. Why do you got to use words that I don't know? Next is 1C. We just have the 4A definition for the word console, or is it console? Yeah, I think it's console in this case. Cabinet, console, that makes sense. We put lots of stuff in our kitchen cabinets. We got dishes and food, and that's about it. 1D, a chamber having temperature and humidity controls and used especially for incubating biological samples. Does it also incubate numismatic samples? Probably not, because I still don't know what that word means. 2A is archaic, a small room providing seclusion. 2B, a small exhibition room in a museum. 3A is also archaic, and we have 3A1, the private room serving as council chamber of the chief, counselors, or ministers of a sovereign. 3A2, the consultations and actions of these counselors. Counselors is not spelled how I would have expected it to be spelled. Okay, now we have 3B1, which is often capitalized, a body of advisors of a head of state. Their cabinet, you've heard about that with, the president of the United States has a cabinet. They have a whole group of people. But why is it a cabinet? Why is it called a cabinet? I don't know. Maybe the etymology will help, but we have more that we have to get through. 3B2, a similar advisory council of a governor or a state, governor of a state or a mayor. So the mayor has a cabinet, the governor has a cabinet, the president has a cabinet, and they hold dishes and food in their cabinets. If you call people dishes and food, then that is the case, but that's not what it is. Next is 3C is British, a meeting of a cabinet. And then number 4 is from New England. It's the synonym milkshake. So they in New England, people call milkshake cabinet. Why? Are you from New England? Can you tell me why you call a milkshake cabinet if you do? I think that's great. Makes no sense, but I think that's great. So this is from Middle French. It means small room. Let's see, from cabine, which means gambling house. So I still don't really understand why they call the political cabinets, but okay, I guess we'll move on to the second form of cabinet, adjective from 1631. One, of or relating to a governmental cabinet. Two, suitable by reason of size for a small room or by reason of attractiveness or perfection for preservation and display in a cabinet. 3A, used or adapted for cabinet making. 3B, done or used by a cabinet maker. And that is our next word, cabinet maker, all one word, noun from 1681, a skilled woodworker who makes fine furniture. Cabinet making is a noun. I am very much not a skilled woodworker. My grandpa, he's not really woodworking these days, but he used to be a very skilled woodworker. He probably could have made a cabinet. I don't know if he ever did, but he could have if he wanted to. Next is cabinetry, noun from 1908, and a synonym is cabinet work. Also, another synonym, just cabinets, as in kitchen cabinetry. Wow, that word sounds weird. And our next is actually cabinet work. See how they just blend from one right into the next? This is a noun from 1732, finished woodwork made by a cabinet maker. Next is cabin fever, two words, noun from 1918, extreme irritability and restlessness from living in isolation or a confined indoor area for a prolonged time. I wonder if this word was coined during the pandemic from that year. Everybody got cabin fever, but why didn't they call it like room fever or house fever or apartment fever? Why is it cabin fever specifically? Next is cabin mate, one word, noun from 1647, one of two or more persons sharing the same cabin. It's like roommate or flatmate or something like that. Next is cable, C-A-B-L-E, first form, This is a noun from the 13th century. 1A, a strong rope, especially of 10 inches, 25 centimeters, or more in circumference. Really? A cable has a very specific size designation, at least in this definition, 10 inches in circumference. That's pretty big. I mean, that's a pretty thick cable. 1B, a cable-laid rope. 1C, a wire rope or metal chain of great tensile strength or tensile strength. 1D, a wire or wire rope by which force is exerted to control or operate a mechanism. 2, synonym is cable length. 3A, an assembly of electrical conductors insulated from each other but laid up together, as by being twisted around a central core. 3B, synonym is cablegram. That's all one word, which was, that'll be in the next episode. And then also a radio message or telegram. So it's like a telegram or a radio message via cable. So it's a cablegram. 4, something resembling or fashioned like a cable, as in a fiber optic cable. 5, synonym is cable television, as in a house with cable. I think when I was little, we had cable, but then for most of my childhood, we didn't have it. So I lost out. I missed out on a lot of things that everybody else knew about. But then we got cable when I was a bit older. All right. Let's see. Next, any etymology that we want to say. This is from Middle Latin capulum, which means lasso. From Latin capere, which means to take. So you take something with the lasso, and there's more at the word heave, H-E-A-V-E. Now we have the second form of cable. This is a verb from circa 1500. First is transitive. 1, to fasten with or as if with a cable. 2, to provide with a cable or cables. 3, to telegraph by submarine cable. 4, to make into a cable or into a form resembling a cable. And then the intransitive definition says, to communicate by a submarine cable. And then cabler is a noun, the one who is doing the cabling. Let's see, cable car is next. 2 words, noun from 1874. A vehicle moved by an endless cable. It's endless. It never ends. It's probably on a loop. So that was the main definition, but then we have an A and a B. So there wasn't enough to put a 1 because it's really just 3 versions of 1, but why wouldn't that one be A? Anyway, it's just a vehicle moved by an endless cable, and then we have A, 1 suspended from an overhead cable, and B, 1 that moves along tracks. And then our last word for this episode is cable cast, 1 word, noun from 1973, a cable television transmission. And cable cast is also a verb. So it's just a broadcast over cable. A lot of broadcasts happen over the networks. You know, ABC, CBS, NBC, those are not on cable. But then if you broadcast something over cable, you can call it a cable cast, which sounds just weird. So we had cabin, cabin boy, cabin car, cabin class, cabin cruiser, cabinet, cabinet maker, cabinetry, cabinet work, cabin fever, cabin mate, cable, cable car, cable cast. Well, I gotta pick cabin fever as the word of the episode because, boy howdy, are we all experiencing some cabin fever right now. You know, we try and get out as much as possible. We go for long walks. My wife and I went on a long walk today. It's Sunday as I'm recording this. And you know, that's good. You gotta get out. But when you walk by people, you should have a mask on because you never really know. So cabin fever is what we are all experiencing these days. So thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information to you. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Thank you very much for joining me. And let's see, we are still on page 171. And I got some words to tell you about, so I'm going to do that right now. The first word is cablegram. It's all one word. We mentioned it in the last episode. This is a noun from 1867, a message sent by a submarine telegraph cable. It's I don't know if the cables are literally just through the water. Are they on the ground? When were the first cables put in the water? Must have been run by some sort of submarine, but I don't think they're actually going through the submarine because the submarines have to go through the water. How does this all work? How did people figure out how to do this? Very, very smart people. So thank you to them for letting us send cablegrams. A word I never heard of, I don't think. Next is cable knit. Cable hyphen K-N-I-T. This is an adjective from 1950. Having or made with a knitting stitch that produces a pattern resembling the twist of a usually two-ply cable, as in a cable knit sweater. What is a two-ply cable? Is that a knitting thing? Is that with yarn? I mean, I know the thing is made with yarn, but what is, I don't know, maybe we should find an example of a cable knit sweater. Next is cable laid, two words with a hyphen, adjective from 1723, composed of three ropes laid together left-handed, with each containing three strands twisted together. So you take three strands, you twist them, you do that three times, and then you've got three ropes, and they've been laid together, I guess? All right. Next is cable length, two words, noun from 1555. A maritime unit of length variously reckoned as 100 fathoms, 120 fathoms, or 608 feet. What? Okay, so a length of cable, it sounds like those are different options. It could be 100 fathoms, it could be 120 fathoms. I don't know how far a fathom is, maybe we should find out. Or 608 feet. So is 608 feet one of those lengths? Is it different than that? Who figured out these lengths? What is going on here? Let's find out more about cable length. All right, next is a cable modem. Two words, noun from 1983. I bet you didn't know that was from 1983. A modem for connecting a computer to a network over a cable television line. I think some of you younger folks probably were like, well, cable modems have been around for my entire life, so they must have been around for the last like 300 years, right? No, it's less than 40 years old at the time of recording, which, you know, to you is probably a really long time, but you know, to me, I'm older than that, so this is a relatively new thing. Because I'm not that old, am I? All right, next is cable television, two words, noun from 1951. A system of television reception in which signals from distant stations are picked up by a master antenna and sent by cable to the individual receivers of paying subscribers, called also just cable TV. Weird Al actually has a great song called Cable TV, which I think was from the early 80s, even though this came out in the 50s, you know, but it didn't become probably quite as common until the 70s and 80s. So maybe we should play a clip of Weird Al's Cable TV. Now I never want to leave my apartment, because there's just so much for me to see about cable TV. Cable TV. Well, if you need to find me, you know where I'll be. Watching my cable TV, yeah. So next we have cableway, one word, noun from 1891. A suspended cable used as a track along which carriers can be pulled. Next is cabman, C-A-B-M-A-N, noun from 1831. Synonym is cab driver. So you could also say that if somebody likes Cabernet Franc, Cabernet Sauvignon, those are wines that we talked about two episodes ago. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you should go back and listen to that. But if there is a man who likes Cabernet, you could call them a cabman. I am not a cabman. Next we have cabochon, C-A-B-O-C-H-O-N, noun from 1825. A gem or bead cut in convex form and highly polished but not faceted, which means it doesn't have faces. It's polished and it's shiny, but there are no individual faces. And then also, this style of cutting is called cabochon. Cabochon is also an adverb. So I'm seeing in the etymology this Picard again, and I think, yeah, I've seen it probably at least three or maybe four times just in these last three episodes. So I really, really should probably go do some research to figure out what this is. But yeah, it comes after the Middle French dialect. It says Picard. And then it says caboche, 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 which means head. So it has to do with the head. Maybe it looks like a head once it's been cut and polished. I don't know. But yeah, so that's probably where they do this gem cutting in this area of France, sort of. Okay, next is caboodle. It is a noun from 1848, and we have the synonym collection or lot, as in sell the whole caboodle. And then oftentimes we hear people say kit and caboodle. So let's see. This is probably from the prefix ka, which is an intensive prefix, plus the word boodle. Oh my God, did we read the word boodle? I really feel like I should go back and look. We probably did. I've read so much. Let's see. B-O-B-O-U, B-O-R. Ooh, here we go. Booby trap and boodle. Yeah, it's just a collection or a lot of people. It's just some stuff. It's some stuff. But why did they call it a caboodle? Because that's an intensive prefix, so it's a very intense boodle. Does that make any sense to anybody? I don't think so. Okay, moving on to caboose. Noun from 1732. 1. A ship's galley. 2. A freight train car attached usually to the rear, mainly for the use of the train crew. So no passengers can go there, but the train crew can do stuff on there. 3. One that follows or brings up the rear. And 4, synonym is buttocks. In movies, they show the caboose a lot. People are trying to catch the train or they throw somebody off the train. But is it really that easy to jump on the back of a train? I can't imagine it is. And there's probably crew people there, you know, pushing them off or not letting them jump on. Next we have cabotage. C-A-B-O-T-A-G-E. It's like the word sabotage, but let's find out what this one means. It is a noun from 1801. 1. Trade or transport in coastal waters or airspace or between two points within a country. Trade, there's a lot of ors. Trade or transport in coastal waters or airspace or between two points within a country. And 2, the right to engage in cabotage. So this is French from caboter, which means to sail along the coast. Man, that's so... I've never heard of this. Okay. Still don't understand what it means. Next, we have cabretta. Cabretta. C-A-B-R-E-T-T-A. Noun from 1894. A light, soft leather from skins of hairy sheep. Okay. So this is modified of the Portuguese and Spanish cabra, which means goat. So, you know, they probably made these from the skins of goats and sheep, and it's the small thing, so they call it a cabretta. Next, we have cabrilla, cabrilla, C-A-B-R-I-L-L-A, similar to caballero with the double L. It's a yuh sound, cabrilla, noun from circa 1839. Any of various sea basses, that's the fish, not the... I was thinking bass, but no, that's pronounced differently. Sea basses of the Mediterranean, the California coast, and the warmer parts of the Western Atlantic. Cabrilla. And this is also Spanish, diminutive of, again, cabra, which means goat, from Latin capra, which means she-goat. Man, I'm having a deja vu. We probably read another word that was similar to this, had similar etymology. Capra is she-goat, which is the feminine of caper, which means he-goat. And there's more at capriole, capriole, with a C-A-P. Okay, so it's some fish. Oh, and then the genera names are Epinephilus and Paralabrax. Paralabrax. Sure, why not? All right, next we have cabriole. Cabriole. Noun from circa 1769. One, a ballet leap in which one leg is extended in midair and the other struck against it. Okay, well, let's see if we can find a picture of sort of what this looks like when a ballerina is in the air. Number two, a curved furniture leg ending in an ornamental foot. Well, maybe we can put a picture of that too. So we have two things, cabriole. Okay, moving on to cabriolet. Similar, but different. Noun from 1770. And if we actually go back to the word cab, that is short for cabriolet. So now we get to learn what that is. Okay, number one, a light two-wheeled one-horse carriage with a folding leather hood, a large apron, and upward curving shafts. We'll find a picture of this and post it as well. And number two, a convertible coupe. That's a cabriolet. And this is French from cabriolet, which means caper, alternative of Middle French capriole. And that is all that. And then, so we have next is cab stand, one word, noun from 1834. A place where cabs await hire. You've probably seen out in front of a hotel, there's a huge line of cabs waiting there, and that is a cab stand, I guess. They're just waiting in line for somebody to need a cab ride somewhere. This doesn't exist quite as much as it used to since we've got Uber and Lyft now. Also, there's a pandemic, so that changes everything. And then our last word is a prefix. It is C-A-C or C-A-C-O, which I guess you could pronounce cock or caco, but I guess it depends on the context. And it just means bad. That's what it means. And the synonym, or no, the example is cacography. C-O-C-O, no, C-A-C-O, graphy. Let's see, are we going to come across that one? Cacography. No, I don't think that's in the book here. So we have to find out what, you can go look up what cacography is, but it's some sort of graphy that's bad. I don't know why. But this is from Greek, kak or kako, with k's instead of c's, and that just means bad. So we had cablegram, cable knit, cable laid, cable length, cable modem, cable television, cableway, cabman, cabochon, caboodle, caboose, cabotage, cabretta, cabria, cabriole, cabriolet, cab stand, and kak or kak. Let's see. Let's pick caboodle as the word of the episode, just because it's a lot of stuff, and I'm looking at the one. Yeah, it's a lot of stuff, and that's what this book is. It's a whole lot of stuff. So thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. We are at the last section of page 171. Please tell people about this podcast if you think it is interesting, if you think it is educational, if you think kids would like it, if you think adults would like it, if you want to make fun of it, if you want to use it as a sleeping aid, please tell the people. I would very, very, very much appreciate some ratings and reviews, especially on things like Stitcher and Spotify and Apple Podcasts, more than probably the other ones. That would be great if you enjoy this, or if you don't enjoy it, I guess just write it up in a review and tell the people what you think so people can know about it. And then of course, if you want to contact me, I post pictures on Instagram. You can message me there, or you can comment on the pictures and say, why did you post that picture? That was a stupid picture. Or thank you for posting that picture. That was really a great visual representation because I didn't know how to look it up myself. Or you could send me an email. All of that is in the episode description, but I think it's dictionarypod@gmail.com and dictionarypod in pretty much all the other places. Okay. Oh, there's an ambulance. All right, the first word is it's a good one. Most of you are going to enjoy this. It is caca, C-A-C-A, noun from 1879. Synonym is excrement. Lots of different words to say that. The etymology says this is baby talk because, you know, babies can't talk. That's what people like, adults like to say caca to their babies. Next we have, or I should say, there are a lot of words in this episode that are very, very much not familiar to me, and I will screw up their pronunciations, but I'm going to figure it out as best I can. I already read through them once, but it takes a second to figure out how do you say these? So like this one, Kakani, I think that's what it is. I should probably move my paperclip out of the way. Kakani. So it is C-A apostrophe, which I'm assuming is the word call in Scottish, if we go back to the first episode of the C's. And then the word canny, C-A-N-N-Y. Kakani. This is a noun from 1886. It is British, I'm assuming also Scottish, and the synonym is slow down, or just slow down, one word. Kakani is also an intransitive verb in British, so this is from Scottish. It is a verb which means to proceed cautiously. Kakani, or is it kokani? So it's from ka, which means call, plus kani or canny, which means careful. I'm very curious to know some context. If you could, somebody tell me the context, a sentence, if you could use this in a sentence, that would be great. I also have a Google Voice number, so if you want to leave me a message, I can play that in an episode, so I can hear how this is pronounced and how this sounds in context. Please and thank you. Okay, next we have a word that I always say, cacao, which is one of the appropriate pronunciations, but it looks like you can also say cacao, cacao. It is spelled C-A-C-A-O. This is a noun from 1555. One, the dried, partly fermented fatty seeds of a South American evergreen tree that are used in making cocoa, chocolate, and cocoa butter, called also cacao bean or just cocoa bean. And then number two, a tree having small yellowish flowers followed by fleshy pods from which cacao is obtained. The scientific name is Theobroma cacao of the family Sterculiaceae. Sterculiaceae. And there is a picture of the number two definition of this, these cacao beans, these fleshy pods, and they just look like, these pods, these beans hanging off of a branch, and it shows the leaves if you want to see what the cacao leaves look like. This is Spanish from the Nahuatl word, cacahuatl, cacahuatl. And I've always been curious, is this the same as cocoa? But it looks like, and I sort of gathered this, but it looks like this is actually where cocoa comes from, or what they make cocoa from, the cacao. Why did they change the vowels around? C-A-C-A-O became C-O-C-O-A. What happened there? Why did that happen? Cacao is good. If you get some like raw organic cacao, that's a really good, healthy thing to have. Good. Go do that. Next, we have cacao butter, and this is a variation of cocoa butter. Next is cacciatore, C-A-C-C-I-A-T-O-R-E, cacciatore, adjective from 1930, cooked with tomatoes and herbs and sometimes wine, as in chicken cacciatore. Yes, you should go remember that tomatoes and herbs and sometimes wine, if you cook with that, you can call it a cacciatore. Can I have a peanut butter and jelly cacciatore, please? This is an Italian word from cacciatore, which means hunter. But why? That doesn't make any sense. Why? I mean, cacciatore means hunter, but I don't know. I just don't understand why you put that? What does that have to do with tomatoes and herbs and sometimes wine? Are you hunting the tomatoes? All right, moving on to, let's see, cachaça. I think that's how it's pronounced. Cachaça. It is spelled C-A-C-H-A-C-A, but the last C has the little sort of question mark S-shaped thing at the bottom of it, which in this case is Brazilian Portuguese. I think I also use it in French maybe sometimes, but that becomes an S sound, cachaça. This is a noun from 1821, a Brazilian liquor distilled from sugarcane. Oh boy, I need some of this. Cachaça. Okay, I like that. Next is cachalot. Cachalot. C-A-C-H-A-L-O-T. Cachalot. Or it could also be cachalot. This is a noun from 1740, and the synonym is sperm whale. So that's just a kind of whale, and this is the French, so the French call sperm whales cachalot or cachalot, I guess. All right, next is cache, but it is spelled C-A-C-H-E, first form noun from 1797, 1A, a hiding place, especially for concealing and preserving provisions or implements. You can have a cache of food, of weapons, of whatever. 1B, a secure place of storage. 2, something hidden or stored in a cache. So you could have a cache in a cache. 3, a computer memory with very short access time used for storage or frequently or recently used instructions or data, called also cache memory. So sometimes you got to clear the cache. Your computer stores this cache memory somewhere, and it just makes it easier going forward, but sometimes you need to empty it out because it takes up space or there could be bad files in there. So you got to do that. This word is French from cacher, which means to press or hide, from Vulgar Latin coacticare, which means to press together, from Latin coactare, which means to compel, cogere, which means to compel, but it's more at the word cogent. All right. Next is the second form of cache, spelled the same way. It is a transitive verb from 1805, to place, hide, or store in a cache. I am caching my cache in a cache. That is technically a proper sentence. Next is one of those other words that are hard to pronounce. It is cachectic. Cachectic. C-A-C-H-E-C. What did I say? C-A-C-H-E-C-T-I-C. Cachectic. This is an adjective from 1634. Affected by... how do you say this word? Oh, this is a word that comes up at the end of this episode, isn't it? Yes, it is pronounced cachexia. It is spelled C-A-C-H-E-C. E-X-I-A, cachexia. So cachectic is affected by cachexia. And there is a bunch of etymology. It's from French and Latin and Greek, but it doesn't really help us understand, so we'll find out when we get to the word cachexia at the end of this episode. All right, next we have cash pot, or cash po, or cash... cachepo. Wow, there's a few different ways. It looks like cash pot. Noun from 1854, an ornamental receptacle to hold and usually to conceal a flower pot. And this is French from cacher, which means to hide, plus pot, which means pot. So you're hiding a thing in the flower pot? Cash pot? Okay. Next is cachet, C-A-C-H-E-T. Noun from circa 1639, 1A, a seal used especially as a mark of official approval. 1B, an indication of approval carrying great prestige. 2A, a characteristic feature or quality conferring prestige. 2B, synonym is just prestige, as in being rich doesn't have the cachet it used to. And that is a quote from Truman Capote. Number three, a medicinal preparation for swallowing consisting of a case usually of rice flour paste enclosing a medicine. 4A, a design or inscription on an envelope to commemorate a postal or philatelic event. Philatelic is starts with a PH, in case you want to go look that up right now. 4B, an advertisement forming part of a postage meter impression. And 4C, a motto or slogan included in a postal cancellation. So many different options for cachet. And this is just French from cachère. Next we have cachexia, C-A-C-H-E-X-I-A. This is a noun from circa 1538. General physical wasting and malnutrition usually associated with chronic disease. So this is definitely something that you don't want. Try not to get those chronic diseases so you will hopefully not have cachexia. But also just just eat healthy and exercise, even just a little bit every day. How many times can I say this on this podcast? But it's very important. We have become very, very sedentary as a society, especially here in America. We don't move as much as we should. We eat very, very bad food. You know, in moderation, it's okay, but you got to make sure that you eat good and you get some exercise. You got to get your butt up. You got to go for walks. You got to do some muscle training and strength training and all that. You know, you're not going to get super bulked. Just a little bit is good. And then if you can do more, that's even better. But we don't do anything. We got to get up so we don't get cachexia. You got to eat good. All right, I got to shut up now. So this is from Greek cachexia, which is bad condition. And that is from, let's see, hexis, which means condition, from etching, which means to have or be disposed. And there's more at the word scheme. So back in the day, the Greeks, when they saw somebody who were in just a bad way, they said, you got the cachexia. And then our last word for this episode is cachinate. Cachinate. C-A-C-H-I-N-N-A-T-E. Intransitive verb from 1824. To laugh loudly or immoderately. Cachinate. Cachinate? To laugh loudly or immoderately. And cachination is a noun. The etymology is not very helpful, so I like that one. So we had caca, cacenny, cacao, cacao butter, cacciatore, cachesa. Sorry, I have to look at the pronunciation to figure out how to say these words. Cachesa, cachalot, or cachalo, cash, cachectic, cash pot, cachet, cachexia, and cachinate. Man, there were some good ones in here. I think I'm going to pick cachinate as the word of the episode because it means to laugh loudly or immoderately, and I don't get to do that as often as I would like, but oh boy, I love it when we have a good laugh. My wife and I recently watched Bob's Burgers, and there was this whole thing about rolling the R's, and so we had a fun discussion about rolling R's and how one of us could maybe not do it, and we just had a good laugh about that. All right, that's all I got to say today. We have finished page 171. Tomorrow, we will be on 172. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. This is the podcast about everything. We are starting at the top of page 172. And hoo boy, I was looking through the words in this episode, and they are fun and hard to pronounce, and words I have never seen before, most of them, mostly the first half as well. So let's get into these crazy, weird, rare words. The first word is cashew, or cashew, C-A-C-H-O-U, noun from circa 1879, a pill or pastille used to sweeten the breath. You know, I know that is a mint, but it's also a cachou. So this is from a Portuguese word, Kashu from a Malayalam word, Kashu, I assume it's pronounced Kashu, K-A-C-C-U. So this is an old school mint. Next is Kasik, C-A-C-I-Q-U-E, noun from 1555. One, a native Indian chief in areas dominated primarily by a Spanish culture. And then at the beginning when I said these are rare words, obviously these are more rare in English American or just American English. Well, how does that go? American English. But obviously in these other languages, Portuguese, French, Spanish, and other ones, they are not going to be as rare. Okay, number two for cacique, a local political boss in Spain and Latin America. And caciquism is a noun, which is C-A-C-I-Q-U-I-S-M. And this is a Spanish word from a Taino word, which means chief. Next we have cack-handed. Yeah, it's like left-handed, but with a cack at the beginning. C-A-C-K, and then a hyphen. Adjective from 1854. Number one is British. Oh, the synonym is the number one definition for left-handed. So I guess I am cack-handed. And then number two is also British. Oh, I don't like this one as much. It is, the synonyms are clumsy and awkward, although that does kind of describe me. So I guess you could, maybe they often say people who are left-handed are clumsy and awkward, which in my case is probably true. So this is an English dialect word for from cack or keck, K-E-C-K, which means awkward. Next we have cackle. Intransitive verb. Let's see, is it also transitive? No, I think it's just intransitive. From the 13th century. One, to make the sharp broken noise or cry characteristic of a hen, especially after laying. Huh. I mean, I've never been around chickens too much, so do they cackle? Do they make a noise after they lay an egg? If I were a hen, I probably would. That's probably painful, but I didn't know this. I should ask some people who got some chickens to see if they do that. Okay, number two, to laugh, especially in a harsh or sharp manner. Three, synonym is chatter. Cackle is a noun, and the cackler is also a noun. Let's see. Okay, next is cacodemon. Cacodemon. C-A-C-O-D-E-M-O-N. This is a noun from 1594. The synonym is just demon. And cacodemonic is an adjective. But why? Where does this prefix come from? C-A-C-O. This is from Greek kakodaimon, which is from the prefix kak, K-A-K, which means the prefix kak, C-A-C, which did we read that in the last episode or a couple? Oh, at the end of two episodes ago. Oh, it just means bad. I should remember that. So it's basically a bad demon. But aren't demons supposed to be bad anyway? It's kak plus daimon. That's Greek, and that means spirit. So it's bad spirit, which we just shortened down to just demon. So I guess that's probably where the word demon came from. Next, we have cacodylic. Cacodylic acid. C-A-C-O-D-Y-L-I-C. Second word is acid. Noun from 1850. A toxic crystalline compound of arsenic, C2H7ASO2, used especially as an herbicide. And let's see, this is from some scientific stuff. Let's see, the Greek kakodes, which means foul smelling, which is from kak, which means bad, and odes, which is, akin to the Greek ozine, to smell. There's more at the word odor. This just means bad smelling stuff. That's what I'm taking from that. Next, we have cacoethes. Cacoethes, or cacoethes. Cacoethes, yeah, something like that. C-A-C-O-E-T-H-E-S, and the E has an umlaut over it. Cacoethes. This is a noun from circa 1587, an insatiable desire. Synonym is mania. So this is from the Greek Cacoethes, with a K's instead of C's, which means wickedness. That is from the neutral word Cacoethes, but it's spelled the same way, which means malignant, from cac plus ethos, which means character. So it's basically like bad character. And there's more at the word sib, S-I-B. Cacoethes, you have an insatiable desire. Next is cacography, C-A-C-O, and then graphy, noun from 1580. One is bad spelling. And then it says compared to the word orthography, which I assume is good spelling. So if you're a bad speller, you've got the cacography. Number two is bad handwriting. I sort of lean this direction. I sort of have cacography. I'm not terrible. I've seen some people who is just, their writing is just completely illegible. And then compare to calligraphy. So good handwriting is calligraphy. Bad handwriting is cacography. Because, of course, we know that the C-A-C-O or just C-A-C prefix, it means bad. And then bad spelling is cacography. And good spelling is orthography. And then cacographical is a funny word. And that's an adjective. Next, we have cacomistle. C-A-C-O-M-I-S-T-L-E. I guess you could also pronounce it cacomistly. Cacomistly. This is a noun from 1869. Synonym is the number two definition for the word ringtail. Let's look at the etymology for some more information. This is Mexican Spanish from the Nahuatl word tlacomitzli, which is from tlaco, which means half, plus mitzli, which means mountain lion. So it's half mountain lion. But what's the other half? You're not telling me what the other half is. So maybe we can find a picture of this. This is probably one of those mythical creatures, a cacomistl or a cacomistli. Next is cacophonous, adjective from 1797, marked by cacophony or harsh sounding. And don't worry, cacophony is our next word. And cacophonously is an adverb. And let's see, so this is from the Greek word kakophonos, which is from the kak prefix, which means bad, plus phony, which means phony, P-H-O-N-E, which means voice or sound. There's more at the word ban. So it's bad voice, bad sound, something like that. And if you know the word cacophony, then you sort of understand that. But if you don't know it, I'm going to tell it to you right now. Cacophony is a noun from circa 1656. Harsh or discordant sound. The synonym is the number two definition for the word dissonance. And then specifically, harshness in the sound of words or phrases. There's a lot of stuff going on. It sounds bad to your ear, and it's a cacophony, and then that thing would be cacophonous. Next is, it's a so much easier word to say and spell and understand. It's just cactus. Noun from 1767, any of a family of plants that have succulent stems and branches with scales or spines instead of leaves and are found especially in dry areas as deserts. Not desserts, deserts. And the family name is Cactaceae, which is the cactus family. And, I don't know a lot about succulents, but I do know that all cactus or all cacti are succulent plants, but not all succulent plants are cacti. So that's one thing. Let's see, this is from the genus name from Latin, cardoon, which is from the Greek cactos. We have a couple succulent plants. I don't think they're cactuses, cacti. Cacti is good, cactuses is good, and then also just cactus for the plural. You can say any one of those things, that's fine. They don't take a lot of water. I think they do need a lot of sun, but ours are not doing so well, and I don't know why. Maybe they're not getting enough sun. I don't think we water them too much, so that's good. Anyway, let's move on to cactus wren, two words. Wren is W-R-E-N, noun from 1869. A large, harsh-voiced wren especially of arid regions of the southwestern U.S. and Mexico. And a wren is a bird. And the scientific name, the binomial nomenclature, is... Oh, this is going to be fun. Campylorhynchus brunicapillus. Brunicapillus. I'm not going to spell that. It is a cactus wren. That's the common name. Next is cacuminal. C-A-C-U-M-I-N-A-L. Adjective from 1862. And we have the number two definition for the word retroflex. Retroflex. Cacuminal. And the etymology basically says it's from the words that mean top or point. All right. Next is cad. C-A-D. Noun from 1833. One, an omnibus conductor. An omnibus conductor. And if, you know, if we go back to, oh boy, I think it was, yeah, just bus. A number of episodes ago, that bus is just short for omnibus. And we still don't know what omnibus means, but I think it has different meanings. So that's the conductor. The cad is the conductor on the omnibus. Number two, a man who acts with deliberate disregard for another's feelings or rights, which is not good. We don't want that. You have to be respectful of other people's feelings or rights. This is an English dialect word, which means unskilled assistant, and it is short for the Scottish word caddy, which is probably related somehow to the caddy in golf, since I think golf was invented in Scotland. Moving on to CAD again, this one is all caps, abbreviation for computer-aided design. I think some people also say computer-assisted design. There might be even other ways, but no, those are the two main ones, I think. And it's, that we'll learn about that later. Next, we have cadastral, C-A-D-A-S-T-R-A-L, adjective from 1858. One of or relating to a cadaster, which will be our next word. But first, number two, showing or recording property boundaries, subdivision lines, building and related details. And cadastrally is an adverb. So what is a cadaster? It is spelled C-A-D-A-S-T-R-E. I would have expected it to be T-E-R, but it's T-R-E. Noun from 1804. Oh, and this is the last word of this episode. This is an official register of the quantity, value, and ownership of the real estate used in apportioning taxes. So you figure out the value of something and how big it is and all that stuff, and then that's how you figure out how many taxes you owe. And the etymology says this is French from Italian catastro, from Old Italian, catastico, from Lower Greek, katastikon, which means notebook. So they probably would just write all this information in a notebook, and that's where the name came from. But it's also from the word kata, which means by, plus stikos, which means row or line. That's where you get katastikon, row, by row or by line. And there's more at the prefix kata or the word distich. That was fun. All right, so we had a lot of fun words in this episode. Kashu, kasik, cack-handed, cackle, cacodemon, cacodylic acid, cacowethes. These are just fun words to say. Cacography, cacomissile, cacophonous, cacophony, cactus wren, cacuminal, cad, cadastral, Yep, you heard me. Cadaster. As much as I want to pick one of these funny words to me, there are some really good ones. I think I'm going to pick cack-handed because I feel very cack-handed. That is going to be it for this strange episode. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Thank you for joining me. The first word is cadaver, C-A-D-A-V-E-R. This episode is filled with words that I can pronounce much more easily than the last episode. This is a noun from circa 1500. A dead body, especially one intended for dissection. And cadaveric, or cadaveric are adjectives. And then this is from the Latin word cadere, which means to fall. So, oh, that person, they died, and then they just fell down. That's a very lighthearted thing to talk about dead people, but it just seems like a funny word that it came from. So yeah, it's a dead person, and maybe their body got donated to science, with their permission, hopefully. And then, students and doctors and whoever will open them up and look inside and see what's going on in there to learn stuff. All right. Next we have cadaverine. This is a noun from 1887, a syrupy, colorless, poisonous ptomaine, P-T-O-M-A-I-N-E, ptomaine, C5H14N2, formed by decarboxylation of lysine, especially in putrefaction of flesh. So it's this chemical formed by this thing in putrefaction of flesh. Cadaverine. That doesn't sound fun, or it probably doesn't smell so good either. Next we have cadaverous. This is an adjective from 1627, 1a, of or relating to a corpse. 1b, suggestive of corpses or tombs. 2a, synonyms are pallid and livid. 2b, synonyms are gaunt and emaciated. And cadaverously is an adjective. So it's looking like a corpse or related to a corpse or something corpsey like that. All right, away from the dead body words, we are moving on to caddy, C-A-D-D-I-E, or it could be C-A-D-D-Y, noun from circa 1730. Number one is Scottish, one who waits about for odd jobs. We'll get back to that. Number 2A, one who assists a golfer, especially by carrying the clubs. 2B, a wheeled device for conveying things not readily carried by hand, as in a luggage caddy. And then caddy or caddy, those two spellings are intransitive verbs as well. This is from the French word cadet, or maybe they say cadet, because it's D-E-T, I don't know. That's a military cadet. So I think it seems like it came from, I mean, it says it's from the French word, but the Scots used it as one who waits about for odd jobs. And so that's, I'm very much guessing that's where the golfer one came from. This guy was around and he needed a job, and some guy was playing golf and he said, hey, you want to carry my clubs? Because I don't want to do that, and I can give you a few bucks. Although they didn't probably say bucks. I think that's where that came from. All right, moving on to caddis, C-A-D-D-I-S, or D-I-C-E, first form, noun from 1530. Worsted yarn, specifically a worsted ribbon or binding formerly used for garters or girdles, or garters and girdles. Garters and girdles. That would be a good, I don't know, song name, band name, something like that. This is from Middle English, cadas, which means cotton wool. From Anglo-French, cadas. From Old Occitan, cadars. Second form of caddis. This is a noun from 1651. Synonym is caddis worm, also caddis fly. And we are going to have both of them. First is caddis fly. Two words, noun from 1787. Any of an order of insects with four membranous, usually hairy wings, vestigial mouthparts, slender, many-jointed antennae, and aquatic larvae, compared to caddis worm. What is a caddis worm? It's probably one of those babies, but let's find out shortly. The order name for these guys is Trichoptera. Trichoptera. Why is it tri? I don't know. All right. But we're not getting to caddis worm just yet. We got one more in between. It is caddish, adjective from 1868, of relating to or being a cad, as in caddish behavior, also as in her caddish husband. Caddishly is an adverb, and caddishness is a noun. And a cad is a man who acts with deliberate disregard for another's feelings or rights. That's from last episode. Next is caddis worm, all one word, noun from 1622. The larva of a caddis fly that lives in and carries around a silken case covered with bits of debris. What is this debris that it carries around? And why is it carrying it around? So that is a caddis worm. It is probably an alternative of the obsolete word codworm. I wonder if that's in the book here. Which is from the case or tube in which it lives. All right. Next is caddo, capital C-A-D-D-O, noun from 1805. One, a member of a group of American Indian peoples of Louisiana, Arkansas, and eastern Texas. Number two, the language of the caddo peoples. This is American French, caddo, C-A-D-A-U-X, which is modified of the American Spanish caddo jodacho, which is from the caddo language word, which I will not try and pronounce, but it's probably similar, which is a caddo tribe. So I'm recording this on the day after Thanksgiving, and yesterday there were a lot of people, it was great to see, there was a lot of people posting about indigenous peoples, American Indians, obviously on Thanksgiving, you know, they didn't want to say Happy Thanksgiving. They would say Happy Indigenous Peoples Day or something similar to that, which was really awesome. And there were some people who posted a site, which I had seen before. I think it was native-lands.ca. I'm going to double check that and I'll post it in the show notes. But it is this very cool interactive online map where you can zoom into a part of the United States, probably Canada too, actually, and it will show the different regions of the different indigenous peoples, the groups who lived in that area. The whole map is just covered with so many different overlapping groups of peoples, and you know, unless you study this stuff, you never know most of these. You know, we hear about the big names, but I don't know most of these, and so it's a really good way to educate yourself on who used to live on the land that you are currently living in hundreds of years ago, and have vastly been wiped out, and that's sad. And so caddo, this is one of those that lived in Louisiana and Arkansas and eastern Texas, and obviously, I've never heard of them. You probably haven't either. All right, moving on to caddy. Again, this one is with a Y. This is a noun from 1792. One, a small box, can, or chest used especially to keep tea in, like the tea that you drink. It's like a tea caddy. Number two, a container or device for storing or holding objects when they are not in use. This is from the Malay word kati, K-A-T-I, which means catty, C-A-T-T-Y, and I guess we just changed the spelling of it for some reason. Next we have cade, C-A-D-E, adjective from 1551, left by its mother and reared by hand. It's an adjective, yeah, so it's cade. So, and then the synonym is just pet, as in a cade lamb. I've never heard of this before. But it is from the English dialect word cade, which means pet lamb. So that was probably the first one that was, I don't know, reared by hand. Interesting. All right. I want to know, I guess it's a cade lamb. I guess that's the good context. But why don't people use this anymore? Do you say a pet lamb, a domesticated lamb? I don't know. It's very specifically left by its mother and reared by hand. I had a friend who a baby squirrel followed at home, and they had it for a little while, and so I guess that would be considered a cade squirrel. Next, we have the suffix cade, spelled the same way, noun from no date. It just means procession, as in motorcade. And then another example is cavalcade. Next is cadell, C-A-D-E-L-L-E, noun from circa 1861, a small cosmopolitan black beetle. Cosmopolitan? What is this black beetle, like drinking Cosmos and wearing scarves and going shopping? No. Small cosmopolitan black beetle, destructive to stored grain. And the scientific name is Tenebroides mauritanicus. Let's see. This is from, from the Latin word catella, which is the feminine of catellus, which is a little dog, diminutive of the word catullus, which means young animal. All right, we'll have to learn more about this. Cadell, black beetle. Next is cadence, noun from the 14th century. 1A, a rhythmic sequence or flow of sounds in language. Like, my cadence reading this book is often very fast. I'm trying to slow it down. But we don't want these episodes to be a half hour long. 1B, the beat, time, or measure of rhythmical motion and activity. 2A, a falling inflection of the voice. 2B, a concluding and usually falling strain. Specifically, a musical chord sequence moving to a harmonic close or point of rest and giving the sense of harmonic completion. Like, I mean, that's talking about music, but when I end my sentence, it tends to go down, and here is the end of the sentence. See, that's that. Okay, number 3, the modulated and rhythmic recurrence of a sound, especially in nature. Cadenced is an adjective, and cadential is an adjective as well. This is from Old Italian cadenza, which is from cadere, which means to fall, and we learned about that at the beginning of this episode with cadavers. So cadence and cadavers are related etymologically. Next we have cadency, noun from 1627, and we just have the synonym cadence. And then lastly for this episode, we have cadent, C-A-D-E-N-T, adjective from 1605. One is archaic, being in the process of falling, as in, with cadent tears, fret channels in her cheeks, and that is from Shakespeare. With cadent tears, they're falling, fret channels in her cheeks, creates these wet tear-filled channels on her cheeks. Number 2, having rhythmic cadence, as in, his cadent voice. So we had cadaver, cadaverine, cadaverous, caddy, caddis, caddisfly, caddish, caddishworm, caddo, caddy, cade. I think my A pronunciations are wrong in some of these. Cade, cadell, cadence, cadency, and cadent. What do we want to pick? I'm going to pick caddo, C-A-D-D-O with a capital C. That is the group of people who used to live in Louisiana, Arkansas, and eastern Texas, and hopefully some of them still do. That is going to be the word of the episode. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Let's see. We have so much to get through. All right. There's some other fun C words here. I had no idea how many crazy C words there are, and we're only on really like page 2. All right, so the first word is cadenza, C-A-D-E-N-Z-A. This is a noun from 1784. 1. A parenthetical flourish in an aria or other solo piece, commonly just before a final or other important cadence. Number 2. A technically brilliant, sometimes improvised solo passage toward the close of a concerto. Number 3, an exceptionally brilliant part of an artistic and especially a literary work. Cadenza. You know what I think? I think I'm thinking of the word credenza. I think that's a piece of furniture. Cadenza. Cadenza. That is music. Okay, next is cade, oil, noun from 1880, and the synonym is juniper tar. Juniper tar. That is good for that. Next is cadet, noun from 1610. 1A, a younger brother or son. 1B, the youngest son. I guess I'm the cadet because I'm the only son. 1C, a younger branch of a family or a member of it. 2, one in training for a military or naval commission, especially a student in a service academy. And then number 3 is slang. It's the word pimp. Cadetship is a noun. And this is from French Gascon, which is, Gascon, G-A-S-C-O-N. That is a language, or maybe it's a subset of French. And that word is capdet or capte, which means chief, from the Latin capitellum, which is from caput, which means head. And there's more with the word head. All right, next is cadet. This one is capital C-A-D-E-T-T-E, noun from 1963. A member of a program of the Girl Scouts for girls in the 6th through 9th grades in school. It's from the word cadet, but they had to make it feminine because that's what people did back then. And they made it E-T-T-E. Next we have cadge, C-A-D-G-E. Verb from circa 1812. Synonyms are beg and sponge, as in cadge a free cup of coffee. You're begging for it, you're sponging it off somebody. You know, we need to bring back a lot of these words, I think. And then a cadger is a noun. This is a back formation from the Scottish word cadger, which means carrier or huckster. Next is cadmium, noun from 1822. A bluish white malleable ductile toxic divalent metallic element used especially in batteries, pigments, and protective platings. And then it says to see the element table because it's one of the elements. There were so many adjectives to describe this. Bluish white, malleable, ductile, toxic, divalent, and metallic. 6 adjectives. This is from the Latin word cadmia, which means zinc oxide, from the Greek word cadmia, spelled differently, which literally means Theban, capital T-H-E-B-A-N, which means earth. Let's see, from cadmos, from the occurrence of its ores together with the zinc oxide. Lots of sciencey stuff there. But next we have more sciencey stuff. It is cadmium sulfide. 2 words, noun from 1869, a yellowish-brown poisonous salt, CDS, used especially in electronic parts, in photoelectric cells, and in medicine. But it's poisonous, so be careful. And then the CDS, that is a capital C, lowercase d, which are the shortened version, the abbreviation for cadmium, and then this the S is a capital S is for sulfide. And then it's just one atom of each of those to make cadmium sulfide. Next is cadmus, capital C-A-D-M-U-S, noun from the 14th century. The legendary founder of Thebes, or is it Thebes? I don't know. But this is back related to the etymology of cadmium. It's from, you know, which is from the Greek word cadmia, which literally means Theban. So it is Cadmus. He founded Earth, maybe? It says it's Latin from the Greek word cadmos. So Cadmos and Thebes and Theban and all that. There's some interesting Greek mythology there that we should learn about. Next we have, you can pronounce this a few ways. Cadre, so many. You could combine these syllables in lots of different ways, and you're bound to say one of them correctly. It is spelled C-A-D-R-E. Noun from 1830. 1. Synonyms are frame and framework. 2. A nucleus or core group, especially of trained personnel able to assume control and to train others. And then broadly, a group of people having some unifying relationship, as in, now how do I want to pronounce this? I'll just say cadre, a cadre of lawyers. Number 3, a cell of indoctrinated leaders active in promoting the interests of a revolutionary party. 4, a member of a cadre. This is from Italian quadro, Q-U-A-D-R-O, which is from Latin quadrum, which means square, and there's more at the word quarrel. So it's a square? I don't understand that. You know, a square makes a space, and then the cadre people go in the space. I'm just making stuff up now. Next, we have Caduceus, or Caduceus, or Caduceus. C-A-D-U-C-E-U-S. This is a noun from 1577. One, a symbolic staff of a herald, specifically a representation of a staff with two entwined snakes and two wings at the top. You've probably all seen this symbol, but didn't know what it was. We have a picture of it. I'll post a picture. But yeah, there's like a sort of sword-looking thing down the middle, and then there's the two snakes going back and forth around it, and then, yeah, there's two wings poking out the top. And then the number two definition says, an insignia bearing a caduceus and symbolizing a physician. So yeah, this is, you see this in medical-related things all the time. Let's see, this is from Greek, kerikion, which is from kerix or kerix, which means herald, akin to the Sanskrit word karu, K-A-R-U, which means singer. So I wonder what the relationship is there. Next we have caducity, or caducity, C-A-D-U-C-I-T-Y, noun from 1767. One, synonym is senility. And number two, the quality of being transitory or perishable. That's good for that, caducity. But next we have caducus, or caducus, C-A-D-U-C-O-U-S, adjective from 1808. Falling off easily or before the usual time. And this is used especially of floral organs. So those are pieces of flowers maybe that fall off, maybe the leaves. Would those be considered floral organs? Now I want to call them florgans. This is from Latin caducus, which means tending to fall, transitory, from our good friend cadere, which means to fall. And there's more at the word chance. So the only example I can come up with is the leaves falling from the trees in autumn. And so maybe those leaves would be caducus, I guess. Next, we have caecal, or caecum, spelled C-A-E-C-A-L or C-A-E-C-U-M. These are variations of just caecal and caecum, spelled without the first A there. Those are probably often used in Britain, but not necessarily. You know, sometimes we use that A-E here as well. And then lastly, we have Sicilian, C-A-E-C-I-L-I-A-N. Sicilian, so many different ways to pronounce these words. Noun from circa 1879. Any of an order of chiefly tropical, burrowing, limbless amphibians resembling worms. I thought they were the Italians, but I guess they're not. Sicilian is also an adjective. This is from the Latin word Sicilia, which means slow worm. Well, sure, I mean, it doesn't have any limbs, so it's pretty slow. And it's also from the word caecus, or caecus, C-A-E-C-U-S, which means blind. So, didn't say that they were blind, but they might be blind. That was our last word, so we had cadenza, cade oil, cadet, cadge, cadmium sulfide, cadmus, cadra, yeah, cadra or cadre, caduceus, caducity, caducus, caecal, and Sicilian. Let's see. I think I will pick, I'll pick cadmus, C-A-D-M-U-S with a capital C as the word of the episode because, you know, he's the legendary founder of Thebes or Thebes. That's pretty important, I think. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. We are at the end of page 172. That is correct. The first number of these words, like the first half, all start with C-A-E, which is not something that we typically use here in English, but you know, you'll recognize some of these words. Maybe not this first one though. It is Caerphilly, capital C A E R P H I L L Y, noun from circa 1893, a mild white friable cheese of Welsh origin. I think that's friable, like it's able to be fried. F-R-I-A-B-L-E, friable. Caerphilly. And this is from Caerphilly, which is an urban district in Wales. It's probably one of the easier Welsh words to pronounce for us Americans. Next we have Caesar. You probably know this. Capital C-A-E-S-A-R, noun from circa 1548. Although Caesar lived much longer before that. One, any of the Roman emperors succeeding Augustus Caesar, and it is used as a title. 2A is often not capitalized, a powerful ruler. And then we have 2A1, synonym is emperor. 2A2, synonyms are autocrat and dictator. 2B, the civil power, a temporal ruler. And this is from the reference in this must be in the Bible, MT 22:21. And then Caesarian is an adjective spelled a couple different ways. But this is from Julius Caesar. And I'm pretty sure that he was the one who got stabbed in the back. Next we have Caesarian. C-A-E-S-A-R-E-A-N, could also be spelled C-A-E-S-A-R-I-A-N. And those are variations of Caesarian spelled C-E-S-A-R-E-A-N. We'll get to that one later. But next we have Caesarian section. Again, this is a variation of Caesarian section spelled differently. Next is Caesarism. Oh, no, it's Caesarism. I'm so dumb. I had that same problem before I recorded this episode. Caesarism, with a capital C, noun from 1857, imperial authority or system, political absolutism. And then a synonym is dictatorship. We don't like that. And Caesarist is a noun. That's probably either the one who is the dictator or the one who would like to have this dictatorship. Next is Caesar salad, noun from 1946, a tossed salad usually made of romaine, garlic, anchovies, and croutons, and dressed with olive oil, coddled egg, lemon juice, and grated cheese. This is not from Julius Caesar. This is from Caesar Cardini, who was an Italian-born but American restaurateur who died in 1957. Man, he really created something that just is going to live on for ages. The Caesar salad. Who doesn't know about the Caesar salad? All right, next is caesium, C-A-E-S-I-U-M, chiefly British variation of caesium without the A. Next is cespitose, C-A-E-S-P-I-T-O-S-E, adjective from 1830. One, growing in clusters or tufts. Number two, forming a dense turf. Okay, next is caesura. Caesura, a couple ways. C-A-E-S-U-R-A, noun from 1556. One is in modern prosody. I don't know what that is. P-R-O-S-O-D-Y. In modern prosody, that's the web we're talking about. Number one is a usually rhetorical break in the flow of sound in the middle of a line of verse. Oh, it's like prose. It's poetry. Number two is Greek and Latin prosody. So Greek and Latin prose or poetry. A break in the flow of sound in a verse caused by the ending of a word within a foot. I would love to see an example of this. Maybe we can find an example and post it on the social media. Number three, synonyms are break and interruption. Four, a pause marking a rhythmic point of division in a melody. And caesural is an adjective? Let's see. So this is from Latin. It's the act of cutting, from caedere, which means to cut. And that's good for that. So it's, yeah, it's a break. It's a cut. It's an interruption. Caesura. Next is CAF, all caps, abbreviation for cost and freight. Next is cafe. You can spell it with a accent, an accent on the E, or without. Noun from 1802. One, a usually small and informal establishment serving various refreshments as coffee. And then broadly, the synonym is the number, no, it's just this restaurant. Number two, synonym is barroom. Three, synonyms are cabaret and nightclub. This is from the French word café, which means coffee, or just café. From the Turkish word kahve, K-A-H-V-E. That probably means coffee. And then there's more at the word coffee. Next is C-A-F-E, all caps, abbreviation for corporate average fuel economy. Next is café au lait. It is three words, technically. Noun from 1763. One, coffee with usually hot milk in about equal parts. Two, the color of coffee with milk. But I do know that like a latte, I guess that would not be coffee. That would be espresso. A latte is made with hot milk and espresso. And then a café au lait is just regular coffee brewed, and then you put some hot milk in there in about equal parts, depending on how you like it. Next is café noir, noun from, oh, by the way, café au lait is French, and it just means coffee with milk. Next is café noir, noun from 1845, coffee without milk or cream. Also, the synonym demi-tasse, D-E-M-I-T-A-S-S-E. And this is French, and it means black coffee. Next is café society. Two words, noun from 1937. Society of persons who are regular patrons of fashionable cafes. Well, I think I would like to go to an unfashionable cafe. I could still be part of café society, though, right? It's just a different kind of society. Yeah, that seems very posh and... You know, it seems very French to me. Just go and you sit in a cafe and it's fashionable. Okay, moving on to cafeteria. First form, noun from 1894. One, a restaurant in which the customers serve themselves or are served at a counter and take the food to tables to eat. Number two, the number two definition for the word lunchroom. So this is an American Spanish word, cafeteria, which is a coffee house, from cafetera, which means coffee maker, from the French word cafetière, which is from the word café. Now we have the second form of cafeteria, adjective from 1951, providing a selection from which a choice may be made, as in cafeteria benefit plan. Also is in a cafeteria curriculum. So it's, you know, if you think about your cafeteria, your lunchroom at school, if you didn't bring out your own lunch, you would get to choose the different things, the different options. So I think that's kind of what this is. It's you get to choose different options for your curriculum or your benefit plan or other examples that I cannot think of right now. Next, we have cafeteria style. Two words with a hyphen, adjective from 1952. The synonym is just cafeteria, as in cafeteria-style benefits, just like the last one. Next, we have cafetorium. This is a noun from 1952. A large room designed to use both as a cafeteria and an auditorium. And it's just combining cafeteria and auditorium. What would this be like? You would use it sometimes as an auditorium, sometimes as a cafeteria. Do you ever use it for the same thing at the same time? A cafetoria? Oh, this seems so silly. Okay, next is CAFF, C-A-F-F, noun from 1931. It is British, and we have the number one definition for the word café, which is just an informal establishment serving various refreshments like coffee. And then our last word is caffeinated. C-A-F-F-E-I-N-A-T-E-D. I am slightly caffeinated right now. This is an adjective from 1971, stimulated by or as if by caffeine, as in caffeinated workers, also as in caffeinated rhythms of electronic music. That is a quote from Mark Weingarten. Mark is M-A-R-C. Number two, containing caffeine, as in caffeinated coffee, opposed to decaffeinated coffee. All right, so we had Carfili, Caesar, Caesarian section, Caesarism, Caesar salad, Caesium, Cespitos, Caesura, CAF, Cafe, CAFE, Cafe au lait, Cafe noir, Cafe society, Cafeteria, Cafeteria style, Cafetorium, Caff, and caffeinated. Let's see. I'll just pick. What do I want to pick? I'll just pick cafeteria as the word of the episode because it's a place that we can't really enjoy these days during the pandemic. But it's a place where people can get together and eat some food and maybe meet some new friends, and that's good. So that's all I got today. Please rate and review this show, especially on Apple Podcasts. The more ratings and reviewings I get, the more people will see this and it will pop up in their feeds. And so that would be great. Please subscribe. Please share. If you want to contact me, dictionarypod@email.com. I'm also at dictionarypod on the social media. There's also a Google Voice number that you can call and leave a message, and maybe I'll play it in a show. Just enjoy it and be kind, be nice to people, help people out, do all those good things. This has been Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. This is happening. We are in the seas. We are well on our way to do all of these words, talk about them. Okay, let's see. We are at the top of page 173. Again, there are going to be some words that are not normal to most of our daily lives, and I will probably screw up their pronunciations. So at the end of the last episode, we had the word caffeinated. And how do you get caffeinated? You get caffeinated from caffeine, which is our first word, C-A-F-F-E-I-N-E. This is a noun from circa 1823. A bitter alkaloid, C8H10N4O2, found especially in coffee, tea, cacao, and kola nuts, K-O-L-A, and used medicinally as a stimulant and a diuretic. This is from the German word caffeine or café, which is coffee. Also from the French café. Next is café latte. Café, C-A-F-F-E, and then L-A-T-T-E, café latte. Noun from 1927, espresso mixed with hot or steamed milk. And this is from the Italian, which is just one word, café latte, which is short for café e latte, which is three words, which is coffee and milk. And then to the end of the last episode, we had café au lait, which is similar, but that's coffee with milk, and this is espresso with milk. Next is caftan, C-A-F-T-A-N or K-A-F-T-A-N, noun from 1591, a usually cotton or silk ankle-length garment with long sleeves that is common throughout the Levant, L-E-V-A-N-T, which I'm guessing is in the Turkish, Russian, Persian region of the world because this is a Russian word, kaftan, and from the Persian word kaftan, spelled Q-A-F-T-A-N. Next is CAG, all caps, abbreviation for Carrier Air Group. Next is the word cage, first form noun from the 13th century. One, a box or enclosure having some open work for confining or carrying animals as birds. If you want a pet bird, you don't want it to fly away, you got to put it in a cage. But also, birds need to fly. So what do you do? What do you do? Next is 2A, a barred cell for confining prisoners. 2B, a fenced area for prisoners of war. 3, a framework serving as support, as in the steel cage of a skyscraper. 4A, an enclosure resembling a cage in form or purpose, as in a cashier's cage. 4B, an arrangement of atoms or molecules so bonded as to enclose a space in which another atom or ion, as of metal, can reside. What is this saying? So if the atoms form a molecule in such a way that there's a space inside that something else, another atom or an ion, can be inside, I think I gotta learn more about this. It's a molecule cage. All right, next is 5A. Synonym is batting cage. 5B, a goal consisting of posts or a frame with a net attached, as in ice hockey. 6, a large building containing an area for practicing outdoor sports and often adapted for indoor events. And cageful is a noun. A cage, it's a cage that's full of something, or you have a bunch, and I think that's right. All right, this is from Latin cavea, which means cavity or cage. Also from cavus, which means hollow. And there's more at the word cave. Second form of cage is a verb from 1556. Looks like it's just transitive. 1, to confine or keep in or as if in a cage. 2, to drive, as a puck, into a cage and score a goal. Next is cageling. Cage and then L-I-N-G, noun from 1823, a caged bird. That's what it is. Why specifically is a bird a cageling? Can anything in a cage be a cageling? Maybe this is based off of some bird name that ends in L-I-N-G, and then that's what that became. Next is cagey, C-A-G-E-Y, or you could take out the E. This is an adjective from circa 1893. I feel like the yawns are coming back. Okay, number 1, hesitant about committing oneself, as in officials are cagey about giving out details. 2A, wary of being trapped or deceived. Synonym is shrewd, as in a cagey consumer. 2B, marked by cleverness, as in a cagey reply. Cagely is an adverb. Caginess is a noun, and it is spelled a couple of different ways, with an E-Y or an I. The origin is unknown. Who was the first one to use it in this way? Next is C-A-G-S, all caps, abbreviation for Certificate of Advanced Graduate Study. Next is a word that is pronounced a couple different ways. I think it's either kaye, or kaye, or kaye. There's kaye or kaye, something like that. It is spelled C-A-H-I-E-R. I'll just say kaye. Noun from 1789, a report or memorial concerning policy, especially of a parliamentary body. This is from Middle French, quaire. Oh, it's probably similarly pronounced to kaye. It's spelled a couple ways, Q-U-A-E-R or C-A-I-E-R, which means choir, Q-U-I-R-E, and there's more at that word, kaye. Okay, next is Kahoot, C-A-H-O-O-T, noun from 1829. Synonym is partnership and league, usually used in plural, as in, they're in cahoots. And this is perhaps from the French word cahout, not pronounced that way, C-A-H-U-T-E, which means cabin or hut. So if that is correct, maybe a couple people were hanging out in a cabin and they partnered up for a business or a project or something, and they said, we're in a cahoot, and then it became cahoots. I just wish that is the correct story. Next is Cahow, C-A-H-O-W, noun from 1615, a dark-colored petrel, P-E-T-R-E-L, formerly abundant in Bermuda, but now nearly extinct. What is this? The scientific name is Pterodroma cahow. Is it a bird? Is it a fish? I'm guessing it's one of those two, most likely. Okay, next is CAI, all caps, abbreviation for computer-aided instruction or computer-assisted instruction, similar to CAD. Next is Cayman, C-A-I-M-A-N, or you can replace the I with a Y. Noun from 1577, any of several Central and South American crocodilians, similar to alligators. The genera names, it looks like there's a few, Cayman, C-A-I-M-A-N, or Melanosuchus, or Paleosuchus. Let's see, this is a Spanish word, probably from the Caribbean word Cayman, C-A-Y-M-A-N, which is probably pronounced Cayman. Oh yeah, we definitely got to post a picture of a Cayman. Next is Cane, capital C-A-I-N, noun from before the 12th century, the brother and murderer of Abel, A-B-E-L. So as the story goes, if you are a reader of the Bible, I think Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel. Were they twins? They were brothers. I think they might have been twins, although I'm not sure. Cain decided to murder Abel for some reason. This is from the Hebrew word Cain, which is spelled Q-A-Y-I-N. All right, next is the suffix Cain, C-A-I-N-E, noun from no year, synthetic alkaloid aesthetic, as in procaine, P-R-O-C-I-N-E. Yeah, it looks like it might be from the word cocaine. It says it's from the German suffix cane, K-A-I-N, which is from cocaine, K-O-K-A-A-I-N. I'm not spelling that correctly, which is the word cocaine. Okay, next is caipirinha, C-A-I-P-I-R-I-N-A-H. Caipirinha, noun from 1973, a cocktail consisting of lime, sugar, and rum. This is from Brazilian Portuguese, caipira, which means backwoodsman, or rustic. I do not think of cocktails as being rustic or in the backwoods. I think of them as tropical and beachy and palm trees and stuff. Definitely lime, sugar, and rum. There must be other ingredients. Oh, rum. Yeah. Okay. So why is this from the backwoods or rustic? Who invented this? Anyway, caipirinha sounds tasty. Not sure if I've ever had one, but I've heard of it. Next is caique. You could pronounce it that way, or you could just pronounce it as caique. C-A-I-Q-U-E, and the I has the umlaut, the two dots, kike, or kaik. Noun from 1625, one, a light skiff used in the Bosporus. Is that a boat? Yes, I think it is, because number two says, a Levantine sailing vessel. That's the second time we've seen Levant or Levantine in this episode, and this is a French word from the Turkish word kaik. K-A-Y, what is that letter in there? Is that an I? K-A-Y-I-K? I can't tell. But yes, it's a boat of some kind used in the Turkish part of the world. Okay, next is, I think it's probably cared or curd, C-A-I-R-D, noun from 1663. This is Scottish and it is a traveling tinker. Also the synonyms tramp and gypsy. So this is from the Scottish Gaelic word caird, C-E-A-R-D, which is a craftsman, akin to the Greek word kerdos, which means prophet. And then lastly, our last word, that's how that works, is cairn, C-A-I-R-N. So it's probably cairn, They probably pronounce it different ways. Noun from the 15th century. A heap of stones piled up as a memorial or as a landmark. And cairned with an ED is an adjective. This is from Middle English, more specifically Scottish, cairn, C-A-R-N-E, from Scottish Gaelic, cairn, C-A-R-N, akin to the Old Irish and Welsh, carn, C-A-R-N, which means cairn. I've seen a few of these. You know, they weren't like authentic cairns. Let's see, we were in Pacific Northwest forest. Was it the Ho Rainforest, maybe? And there was a river, and some people had just built up the rocks and made some of these things. They were small. They were pretty cool, and so I took some pictures of them. And then when we were in Iceland at the top of a waterfall, some people had, probably lots and lots of people over time, had just started throwing basically rocks in a pile. And so there was this, I guess you could sort of consider that a cairn. It wasn't as nice and pretty. But yeah, I mean, that's, maybe this is more accurate to this one. A heap of stones. That's what it was. So I got a picture of my wife putting a stone on to add to this pile. So maybe I'll post that picture. That is that for that and all that stuff. So we had caffeine, cafe latte, caftan, CAG, cage, cageling, KG, CAGS, Kaye, which was the, where was it? Oh, that's a report or memorial something. Kahoot, Kahau, which is possibly a fish or a bird. CAI, Cayman, Cane, the suffix cane. Caipirinha, Caique, Caird, and Cairn. Well, I think I will pick Cairn as the word of the episode. Just because, you know, I like what it stands for. I like the history of it. It's for a memorial or as a landmark, and that's kind of cool. Yeah, so we're going to end the episode there. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye.